A lot of people here, a lot of familiar faces. For those of you who don't know my work or may not be particularly familiar, I'm a painting mixed media artist based here in Raleigh. For the past 5 or 6 years, my work has focused on our complicity in and responsibility for the world. And under that broad umbrella statement are things like notions of beauty, artifice, social dynamics, personal politics and ethics. And when I say our complicity, and really I'm talking about myself, it's about my own negotiation with temporary society. But I'm not here to initially talk about that today. My topic today is about color. When Taylor first asked me to do this, if I'd be interested, I immediately thought, yeah, I use color all the time. It's easy, not easy, but second nature. And then I began to think about how I use color and what it is I do on a daily basis. And what I realize is I hardly ever think about color consciously. It's sort of like that split consciousness you might have when you get in your car and you go to work. You know the way, you do it every day, but you're thinking about your day, you might be on the phone. You get to where you're going with this sort of unacute awareness of the road. And I sort of didn't realize how sort of second nature that had become for me. So when artists deal with color, often we make a few choices. And in those choices, we sort of set up a number of issues we have to solve, whether it's balance, complements, contrast. I'm not always consciously thinking of all the implications of those choices I'm making, but later they become important as I try to communicate whatever it is the narrative might be. So we're going to start with some basics, and this might be really elementary, but what is color? Color is Roy G. Biv, the visible light spectrum, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. And on the most basic level, the visible light spectrum is reflected by objects in the world around us. It's interpreted by the rods and cones in our eyes. Signals sent to our brain that interprets this fabric of reality we experience. And this is the basic color wheel. We start in the center. We have our primaries, red, yellow, blue. If we mix those with their neighbors, we get our secondary colors, orange, violet, green. If we mix those with their neighbors, we get our tertiary colors. These 12 colors sort of make up the basic color wheel. The human eye is capable of detecting almost 10 million different shades of color. And when you think about those 10 million shades, those 10 million choices, those 10 million plus combinations, it becomes exponentially daunting in sort of what we do and negotiate as artists and designers. When artists think about color, designers think about color, it might be a bit different from those who don't deal with it on a daily basis. Those non-practitioners might only think about color when they're dealing with picking out their clothes for the day, nesting, picking out things for their home, shopping, accessories. For artists and designers, we think about it more in regards to color next to color. We develop an acute sensitivity to it. We think about the implications of those colors in regards to communicating and how the viewer might read that in terms of emotionally, symbolically, or conceptually. There is joy, power, and conflict in color. One of the most confusing aspects of color is that our ability to understand it and articulate it is limited by our language. If I say, or I ask you to imagine the color gold, you all have some idea of gold, and it will be close to my idea of gold, but it won't be what I'm imagining. It won't be what your neighbors are imagining. So color is one of the few senses that we articulate, that we describe using nouns rather than adjectives. In that way, color becomes associative. An orange is a citrus fruit. Orange is a color. An orange is orange. Other examples are sky blue, brick red, forest green. It becomes referential. In order to get past this sort of confusion when we're trying to communicate with each other, in my industry, in painting, the paint manufacturers have this consistency in labeling. So no matter what brand I'm choosing, I know that it's basically going to be the same or in the same neighborhood. But the names are based off their mineral content and maybe the region they come from. So burnt sienna, titanium white, Naples yellow. Designers might deal with the Pantone color system, in which these shades are numbered. It helps them create continuity across platforms. So if you're a graphic designer working on an ad campaign, here in Raleigh, but it's going to be printed in San Francisco, you know there will be consistency there. And some other sort of, these might seem really basic, but they are our emotional, psychological, and physiological responses to color. We think of red, we think of stop signs, alarms, power, anger. We think of blue, maybe I'm feeling blue, maybe that's sadness. But color also becomes referential when we think about different palettes. An artist might use a fall palette. We've got Halloween coming, so those browns and oranges and reds makes us think of autumn. Christmas palette, red, green, and white. And it also becomes referential in the sense that it plays off our nostalgia. If we think about different eras in time, the mints of the 1950s, the psychedelic 60s, the fluorescent 80s, artists use these tenets to communicate. Another example, one of the most common palettes and branding is red, white, and blue. And those companies want to align themselves with those associations we make with America. Power, confident, secure, united, capitalist. And in that way, color can become conceptual. This is another view of the color wheel. There are some basic rules in working with color. One rule or tenet is that we use limited palettes. I might use only three or four colors, plus white or black. To use the whole spectrum of color is one of the most difficult things to do because it often feels childish or primitive, and it just becomes so busy. Another tenet is complements. So complementary colors here in the color are shown opposites. Red and green, yellow and purple, orange and blue. And they're called complements because they do just that. They complement their opposite. Red looks more red next to green, green more green next to red. A third tenet, and this especially applies to painting, is distribution. And this is one of the more difficult things to explain, but a little bit of each color in your palette gets mixed with colors next to it. I have some examples from art history just to illustrate those three points. This is Cezanne, and this is a really uncreative title. This is Fruit with Vessel and Napkin. And in this painting, we see a limited palette. At first, it appears to be violet, green, and red, but the violet's a little bit blue. And this one point, yellow, so we have five colors, and that yellow really sets off the whole composition. So it complements red and green, limited palette, and then distribution. So we have this yellow showing up here and here. This same violet shows up in the napkin, in the shadows of the fruit, and the green shows up in here. It creates unity and harmony. Fast forwarding more art history, this is Van Gogh. And immediately when I look at this, I think it's red and yellow, but there's a whole lot of green showing up in that yellow. So we're playing off complements again, activating the picture plane. Law of distribution in terms of all the colors showing up. And there are two places it's really hard to see in this light, but there's a lot of blue here, violet here, and this guy is a very violet blue, and it plays off the orange. So really there's four colors he's using. Moving forward, I wanted to show an example of what I think is a really awful use of color. This makes me want to gouge my eye out. This is Chagall, but he follows some of the rules. It's a primitive palette. Which was, at the time, what he was doing, and it was radical, combining elements of cubism, surrealism, expressionism, law of distribution. We see this yellow showing up in different places, and that yellow mixes with the blue to kind of make a green, which bounces with the red, and the same thing, this orange, yellow, and red kind of mixed together that kind of bounces with the blue. And these three painters came out of the modernist movement, and a funny thing started happening, not a funny thing, but painting kind of became reductive, and there was a critic in the 40s and 50s named Clement Greenberg who argued that not just painting, but all art should stop imitating other art. And that being, they should act within their own parameters. So paint being about paint, literature about literature, music about music. An example of this painting imitating maybe literature would be all the Victorian paintings illustrating Shakespeare or other parts of history. So in his mind, this was a mixing of the two. And someone who came out of that tradition of formalism that Greenberg put forth was Joseph Albers. And he was really the granddaddy of color. He was a teacher at Bauhaus, and in 1933, when it was shut down by Nazi Germany, he fled to the United States and found a teaching position at Black Mountain College here in North Carolina. Some of his students included Robert Rauschenberg and Cy Twombly. In 1963, he published a book called The Interaction of Color. And this piece, along with some other ones I'm going to show, were really about color next to color. And he believed that color was governed by an internal and deceptive logic. And would he often play with these planes against planes and how they might recede or come forward into space. These are called Homage to the Square. And these really aren't great illustrations in terms of the things I was talking about before with the three roles, complements, distribution, unity. But they were just all about meditations on color and color families. Moving along that track in art history, I'm going to fast forward past pop minimalism, post-minimalism, where color continued, or not just color, but figuration and color, were sort of edited out and poo-pooed by the critics. In the 80s, there was a return to figuration. Neo-expressionism, German expressionism, we had figures like Basquiat, Robert Longo, Julian Schnabel, and David Sally. And this is an example by David Sally. And this is the sort of the first example where we get into the postmodernism where color really does become referential. And I wanted to show this example next to the Joseph Albers. It's essentially the same palette with the opposites amplified. So we have all of this orange against this blue, all this gray, red, more violet, and this green and red. And this is really tied together by the flatness of the red on top that flattens out the whole picture pane. It's not a convincing three-dimensional, it's more collaged, flat collaged. We move forward a few more years. This is from 2007. This is by a painter named Dana Schutz. And this is called The Autopsy of Michael Jackson. And she is a painter's painter, and she does that difficult thing that I mentioned earlier, which was using all the colors is almost impossible. It becomes so busy and so difficult, but she manages to do it pretty awesomely. And if you look at how she's sort of pushing our eye around the canvas, we have three planes. We have the bottom, we have this middle ground, Mr. Michael Jackson, and the background. And these intense places of contrast created by complements bounce our eye around. This red, this red, this red, this red, and then sort of through the crowd. And it does the same thing, so we might start on red and then move to blue, and all the blues and oranges. And down here, it's really cool compared to the rest of the palette, but we have that distribution where these yellows show up, those reds show up. Another artist who does a really great job of using the whole spectrum, and I'm really jealous of, this is a street artist named Pose. He's a member of MSG in the Library Street Collective in Detroit, and it's the same deal. I'm really in awe of how he uses every color in the spectrum. It's not overwhelming. It is busy, but we have similar laws of distribution. This overlapping color against the purple complements yellow and violet, splashes of blue that bounce us around. And that's my quick summary through some art history about color. And I wanted to get kind of referential in my own relationship to color throughout my work. I graduated from UNCW in 1999, and later that year moved downtown into a historic duplex, and my upstairs neighbor was this family from Portland, and the man claimed to be an artist. He ended up being more of a sociopath, borderline sociopath, pathological liar. He had big claims, like he was on a softball team with Kurt Cobain. He claimed to be part of the think tank responsible for Freedom Tibet concert series, along with Richard Gere and the Beastie Boys. Who could I say that, you know, he hadn't done those things, you know? But over the course of some years, the lies got too big and they all kind of unraveled. But he made a big impact on me in that, as claiming to be an artist, he had this one painting, and it was the only painting I saw in 3 years. And he had so much conviction about that painting in terms of how he used his palette, subject matter, scale, his brush strokes, that it locked me up. And I'd never thought about anything that holistically. And so I went on this sort of year-long design process where I didn't make a painting for me. I was working as a muralist and a decorative painter for a decorative painting company. So I was getting regular practice, but in terms of making a painting, this is my art, I didn't know what I was doing. And so through that process of elimination, figure out what it was I was interested in painting and art, and what maybe my voice would be and what I had to say, I came to this veiled series. Again, we have limited palette. It's essentially red and green and amplified to yellow, so it's basically warm. And for me, the veils were this distance we placed between ourselves and the rest of the world. And so this classical figuration style of working was what I came to. after the sociopath. I worked this way for about 3 years, and then I sort of took it to its extreme. I got bored. It was repeating subject matter, repeating scenarios. And I had a fellow come to a show I had in New York. I'm sorry, he was from New York. He came to a show I had, and he started a program through SUNY Empire State called the Studio Semester Program, and he offered to make a phone call if I wanted to go. It was this opportunity fell in my lap, so I moved to New York, and a funny thing happened. I started painting the South, and I was in that same place in terms of, grad school, all your choices are questioned, all your intentions are questioned, and the teacher I had, my mentor, who I met with weekly, was really pushing me to stop rendering. He hated my drawing and paint. He wanted to see, like Greenberg, formalism, paint doing what paint does, splashing, oozing, dripping. And so I was sort of exploring that in my own minute moves. This was called Pasture, and I refer to this painting as my mad cow bird flu radiation painting, which was all in the news at the time, especially mad cow and bird flu. This is around 2004, and I worked in this romantic southern way for approximately 3 years as well. And then I decided New York wasn't for me. I left. I hadn't quite digested what I'd experienced in grad school. And I had a layover at my dad's in Virginia before I decided to move to Raleigh, and I was saving money, and I was painting in an attic that was all brown. And I ended up making all these brown paintings, which still very romantic in some ways, like the previous, but the palette is reduced. And part of that, I think, was the experience of being in this wooden room with wood paneling and wood rafters. But it also had to do with economy, in that it wasn't very expensive just to use two colors and buy the same two colors. And this was a mixture of burnt sienna and Payne's gray. Payne's gray is a very blue gray, which ended up giving it a very sepia, sienna type, old photography sort of feeling. And about this time I moved to Raleigh, and I had some success with this work at a few shows and some deadlines to meet coming up. And I managed to get a residency at ArtSpace, their emerging artist program. During that time, I was meeting these deadlines with this sort of work, but I was playing with things. I was trying things using stencils, collage, and mixed media. Most of my experience had been with oil paint. I started using acrylic and sort of mixing those two. And it sort of gelled while I was at ArtSpace. And it looks like at first glance that my palette's just exploded, especially compared to the last two. But it's really the same deal. It's the same limited palette. It's red and green. There's a lot of red and green here. I know it's hard to make out. Distribution, the color of these book pages that are collaged on, echo her color, are echoed up here. And then those places of high contrast using complements, much like the Dana Schutz painting, bounces your eye to different places. So this rhythm here is echoed in these colors here. There's a lot of high contrast in here and her contrast to that. So you start here, and you kind of bounce to different places. This was called Southern States. The quick overview was, in looking back at this piece, I was a latchkey kid. My mother suffered from depression. My father worked full time. So there's a lot of me and my sisters being left to our own devices. I have a friend who calls this my Great Expectations Miss Havisham painting. Fast forwarding to maybe 5 years forward, this is called 86. And this painting and the next one are really my two most difficult challenges with color. This started out in so many different iterations, except I did that precious thing that we're told not to do in art school. And so the eagle, the inverted eagle, was sort of always there, but I was pushing and pulling the background, and there was so much pink and so much orange, and trying to find that balance, but also symbolically, to sort of get across this expression, I was trying to sort of sum up these feelings I was having about our nation and America, and, you know, gridlock in government, and the business of war, school shootings, and juxtaposing these sort of faded colors, faded book page colors, in that sort of creating the idea of antiquity or times gone by. And so this was in this place for a long time that was all that mishmash of colors, pinks and oranges, and then I blacked it all out, except for the tail fin and the eagle. And it stayed that way for months, and then I had this moment of courage, sort of that light going off, and I did that blue, splashy, quick movement with a big brush, and it sort of tied it all together in the sense of this feeling like the sky is falling, referential to the sky, but also maybe we'll think of blue and sadness. So my own sort of feeling about what's been happening in our nation. And then this was my biggest challenge. I don't know if it was a failure or a success. I still feel good about it. This is from a series in 2011 called Concession Stand. That series was about those two words in opposition, things we might concede, things we stand against, but together they form a marketplace. And in a broader sense, it was all about the negotiation we make from being an active participant. We're both target audience, demographic, and I myself am selling something, so wondering where the art was in that. And this was about being marketed our own mortality. Literally, the background is alcohol, tobacco, and drug company ads. The bottle caps are all from alcoholic beverages. And I did a mock-up of this when I was trying to figure out how it would all work, and I used washers on mat board, and it was about 1/3 scale. But I only used 4 colors when I was doing it. Red, green, gold, and silver, which were the most colors I was finding in the bottle caps I was collecting. But then once I got into it and started putting it together, I wasn't prepared for how candy-colored all the bottle caps became. And I was sort of faced with trying to negotiate the full spectrum, which is, as mentioned earlier, a very difficult challenge. And so the background I was depending on to sort of tie in all the bottle caps. And it started out in this blue-gray place with this really hot blaze orange, the RX prescription symbol. And I fell in love with that color, and so I was trying to, my color logic, blue was the obvious choice against that orange, and the tying into all the reds and orange in the bottle caps. But it was just too cold for sort of the statement I was trying to make, and so I thought, maybe if it's more blue, and there's more bounce. So we see more blue showing up in the patterning of pills, and it was still just too cold. And so then I tried pushing it more in relationship to some of the bottle caps that were in the shaded areas of the skull face, of the face, and it was too romantic feeling, for lack of a better way of explaining it. And then I got mad and I made it orange. And in making it orange, I sort of realized that I'd hit on the notes that were in the background pages, and that if you think about branding for Budweiser or Camel or Marlboro, reds and yellows, golds and whites, and it sort of seemed to put it in a place that was more about the seduction that was in advertising that all this work was sort of alluding to and sloganeering and playing on our choices. And so this was the final iteration. I went to yellow, and I meant to mention at some point earlier, but I hate yellow. And so that was the other sort of negotiation I made, which I didn't want to go to yellow. It's not something I'm normally drawn to. But it made sense in terms of the marketing. And this is really all I have for my presentation. I just wanted to share some of those negotiations, my relationship to color, and what we as artists go through when making those decisions. It's not as simple as like, I like pink or I like blue. There are conceptual, referential, nostalgic implications to those choices. And hopefully you guys will leave here today with a greater appreciation of those negotiations. Thank you. There is an artist, and I'm not going to get her name right, Vija, V-I-G-A, Vija Clemens, V-I-J-A, I should say, who does representational work, and there's an Art 21 feature on her if anyone wants to look her up. But she does these realistic drawings of fighter jets, of the night sky and other things, and she talks about why they're black and white, and it's a very interesting take. It's that it removes all sentimentality. So there are times when I will use black and white in that sort of sense that it's, or the issue is black and white, as with the eagle and sort of alluding to the polarization in government. It snuck in there, and by that I mean for years I was using collage background in sort of advertisements for magazines, building up backgrounds, the way it's sort of seen here. I know it's hard to see, but it's there. And slowly the words became important to what I was doing. And in that car crash series, I didn't want to exploit anyone's tragedy. And so I watched a bunch of action movies and took pictures of car crashes from action movies. And I started to see some parallels in the names of these movies. And so one of the pieces I did was Vanishing Point, in which is a 70s car chase movie. The protagonist kills himself at the end rather than being caught by the police. And I've sort of tied that to resource allocation and like this end game of playing with the environment. Lost Highway was kind of the same thing. And what was happening in the news then was mortgage crisis, bailouts, the automobile industry too big to fail. And I thought one take on that whole situation was it was an opportunity for us as society to reset and move to cleaner alternatives. rather than perpetuate this conglomerate that we're slowly losing. And so Lost Highway, making an allusion to that David Lynch movie where it makes no sense, which a lot of David Lynch movies don't make sense. I hope that helps in some thinking. I just use the Constitution in something, specifically rights of individuals. And I still keep going back to advertisements from 1970s Playboys because they're so chauvinistic and it's such about this sort of party lifestyle that I find kind of ironic, I guess. It's all these liquor ads and drink ads and that sort of thing. I had a team of people helping me. Some of them were here. Megan, Lincoln, Hancock, Greg Ettinson, Brandon Cordry, I'm not sure, no, I don't see him, but we would smash them, we'd flatten them, clean them up, seal them with matte medium, and then punch a hole in them. Or not matte medium, but a gloss medium. And so there's a spacer between, anyways, I was standing in the screen, a spacer between the jigsawed out background, the shape of the skull, and the bottle cap that's really tiny. So they kind of, if you put a fan on them, they kind of shimmer. I don't know. I often use the clicker. Orange and blue is something that keeps coming up, but it's also because lately I've been doing things that involve landscape. I prefer cobalts that are really grayed out with white. Cerulean I can't deal with. Ultramarine I can't deal with. Prussian I like a little. Sometimes I'll start my process by playing word games or writing out phrases, or there'll be a phrase that speaks to me, or I may even read a news story somewhere that it's sort of like has some sort of socio-political topic. One of the paintings from a couple years ago I did was Twilight inspired. And I was thinking about teenage girls from 16 to 25 driving the entertainment industry, and that they spend the most money. And so it was sort of a take on that, if that gives you some insight. So it can really kind of come from anywhere, I guess. So the one thing that's changed in my process maybe over the last 2 or 3 years is that I'll start out making collages. So then I have a small sort of reference of where I want the painting to go. But I do sometimes paint things that is just about painting on paper, usually not sort of the grand paint, scale of other things.